So far in this course, we studied simple quantum systems for which we could find the precise energy levels and wave functions by solving the Schrödinger equation exactly. Now, realistic quantum systems will of course be somewhat more complicated than this, and nonetheless, we can make accurate predictions about them. Partially, this is due to the application of sophisticated numerical methods. However, as we will touch upon later, the intrinsic computational complexity of quantum systems is considerable, and this is precisely exploited in quantum computation. So to make any progress, we need to bring this problem into a form where we can approach it systematically. In many cases, this can be achieved by a method known as perturbation theory. And as I will explain as we go along, this method has wide implications even beyond our desire to study some somewhat more complex systems. It is a central tool not just for the evaluation, but also for the formulation of quantum systems, even at the most fundamental level. And as we will see here, in the simple setting, it gives an accordingly simple but general and powerful result. So to set the scene, assume that we have a stationary quantum system that is similar to a quantum system that we understand very well, but differs by some features that require a more careful analysis. In this case, the key idea of perturbation theory is to separate out the features that we understand very well, and then focus on the aspects that require a more careful analysis. So you have your normal quantum system that you understand very well, and these additional features that are generally known as the perturbation. I will soon translate this picture into equations, but before I do so, let me give you some examples. In this course, we often study the motion of a quantum particle in a potential. And as it can happen, the potential might look similar to the potential of a quantum system for which we can find exact solutions. If this is the case, then we can expect that the energy levels of the system that we are interested in are close to the energy levels of the system for which we have the exact solutions. A little bit later in this course, we will study a very simple, marvelous quantum system known as a spin. This fundamental system has only two energy levels, which can be conveniently probed by a magnetic field. So now we can ask what happens to the spin when we expose it to a very weak magnetic field. We will also study the hydrogen atom, one of the really central quantum mechanical systems that we can cover in this course. This is a quantum system where an electron moves around a proton, which is the nucleus of the atom. Well, that's just another quantum system which has energy levels. Atoms such as this can be conveniently probed by exposing them to electromagnetic radiation. And now you can ask what happens to the energy levels when you expose an atom to weak electromagnetic radiation. That's not a stationary system anymore, so we will return to this case a little bit later. As we will see, this will result in transitions between the energy levels of the atom. So this all gives you an overview of some of the very concrete applications of perturbation theory that we will encounter in this course. Now, perturbation theory also plays an important role in fundamental theories of physics. While these theories are beyond the scope of this course, I want to provide you with a general picture. And I will slightly expand on it at the end of this chapter, if only still in words, when we have a better understanding of what this method is about. But just for further motivation, in fundamental theories of physics, we consider the interactions of elementary particles. These interactions are mediated by forces which just involve other types of particles. If we want to do calculations in these theories, we have to take many different interaction scenarios into account, which can be conveniently represented by diagrams such as this. They are famously known as Findman diagrams, and they just represent certain integrals, something also shared by the expressions that we will encounter in our applications of perturbation theory in this course. Second, from a fundamental and very conceptual perspective, physicists often like to categorize phenomena into two very broad categories. On the one side, you have quantum systems that can be well understood from the interplay of their constitutive parts and only slightly change their behavior when this interplay is modified. These phenomena are generally well described by perturbation theory and are therefore known as perturbative. Electrons moving through a clean semiconductor are an interesting example. They really interact with each other and with the solid, but you can conveniently capture this by describing them as particles with properties very similar to a normal electron, but with some changed characteristics, such as their mass or the way their spin responds to magnetic fields. On the other side, you have phenomena where quantum systems completely change their behavior, and these are known as non-perturbative. The formation of localized states in a random potential that I briefly mentioned in our discussion of bound states and extended states is one such example. This can occur, say again, for electrons in a semiconductor, but now in presence of impurities. This does not mean that all is lost. In one spatial dimension, there are very precise descriptions of this phenomenon. You should just not start too naively from plane waves. But it is still fair to think of the perturbative phenomena as being somewhat more easy to understand, while the non-perturbative phenomena can be difficult or hard. On the other hand, there are also some sometimes even very general ideas by which you can relate the physics of these difficult to understand non-perturbative phenomena to the physics of the simpler perturbative phenomena. This can sometimes be achieved by adopting two totally different mathematical formulations on both sides of such a relation. Such relations are generally known as dualities. So, to apply perturbation theory to stationary systems, we need to translate this picture into equations. This can be done by separating the Hamiltonian of our quantum system into a contribution describing the simple system that we understand very well. I sometimes also call this the original, unperturbed, or old system, and a contribution arising from the perturbation. Including this, we then have our more complicated, new perturbed system. In this combination, we include a dimensionless parameter lambda that measures the strength of the perturbation, and we will generally assume that this parameter is small. In this way, we make sure that our new system only differs very slightly from the old system. Our goal is now to obtain an estimate of the energy in an eigenstate of our new system. And we expect that this energy is close to an energy of a state in the simpler system, but differs by some corrections that depend on the strength of the perturbation. We are mainly interested in the leading term of this difference, but in some cases also need to take higher order corrections into account. As shown here, the different orders are distinguished by superscripts. To obtain these corrections, we have to solve the Schrödinger equation, and for this we are going to assume that the new quantum state also only slightly differs from the state of the simpler system. The corrections again depend on the strength of the perturbation. Based on these assumptions, one can now derive general expressions for the corrections of the energies and of the states. I will show you the derivation in detail later, but let us first discuss the main result, which has a simple physical interpretation, as I'll also illustrate in a first example. This main result of perturbation theory is an expression for the leading term of the energy difference between the new and the old energies. We also call this difference the energy shift. This leading correction is simply given by an expectation value, namely the expectation value of the perturbation, which is evaluated in the quantum state of the original system. This has a straightforward physical interpretation, as it describes the averaged energy from the perturbation in this state of the original system. Now I will illustrate perturbation theory by a few examples. In all of these, the quantum system from which we start is the harmonic oscillator. As you recall, the harmonic oscillator is described by a parabolic potential. The ground state energy is given by h bar omega divided by 2, while the ground state wave function looks like a Gaussian. In the first example here, I'm just going to assume that the potential remains parabolic, but is somewhat more shallow. That can be written as shown, so by including an extra term into the Hamiltonian, which is just our perturbation. If we sketch this potential, it may look a little bit more like what is shown here. As this potential remains parabolic, the system is still a harmonic oscillator, and we can therefore still solve this problem exactly. So let us first look at the exact solution. We can obtain this by rewriting the new potential energy in terms of its angular frequency, which I call omega tilde. If we compare the two expressions of the potential energy, we can read off a relation between the new and the old angular frequency. And as the angular frequency can always be taken as positive, it now becomes the square root of omega squared minus lambda divided by m. The new ground state energy is then given by h bar omega tilde divided by 2. As we assume that lambda is small, we can further approximate this in a Taylor expansion. And when we do so, we find that the new ground state energy is approximately given by h bar omega divided by 2 minus h bar lambda divided by 4m omega. Okay, so now let us see if we can recover this expression from our main result of perturbation theory. According to this, the new ground state energy of this modified harmonic oscillator is close to the ground state energy of the original quantum system, plus a leading correction that is given by the expectation value of the perturbation, evaluated in the ground state of this original quantum system. In the present example, the perturbation is given by minus lambda divided by 2 times x squared. By pulling out the constant minus lambda over 2, we see that this expectation value is proportional to the expectation value of x squared in the original system, which we already calculated before. We saw that this expectation value determines the width of the Gaussian wave function, and the result that we obtained was h bar divided by 2m omega, which we also denoted as sigma squared. When we collect our results, we see that the new ground state energy is therefore given by the ground state energy of the original quantum system, h bar omega divided by 2, and a correction, which is minus h bar lambda divided by 4m omega, and comes from our main result. So as you can see, this recovers the approximation that we obtained from the Taylor expansion of our exact result.